I see Angie Parker, Amy Richardson. I think Lee Geis and Jennifer Dudinsky. Sorry, Jennifer, I was looking down through here and trying to do two more than one thing at a time. So I think that's everybody. If there's somebody else from DMS that I've missed, speak up.
All right, we can go ahead and get started. The minutes were attached to the invite. It's the reporting from the last meeting we had in June. Going into old business, HRIP update. I know we've gotten the word that the HRIP was extended from July to December for the current plan, and working on the 2022 calendar year approval. I saw the first quarter notices come out this week. Any update on the 2022 status?
Hi, Russ. This is Amy Richardson. I work for Steve, and he's out of the office today, so I'm filling in for him. Okay. So we did receive approval from CMS for the program from July 1st of 2021 to December 31st of 2021. But we are still in the process of working with CMS and providing some documentation for the approval of the calendar year 2020 program.
Okay.
2022 program, I'm sorry.
Okay. I appreciate that. And like I said, we got the notices for the first quarter and appreciate those getting processed. Thank you very much.
Okay, no problem.
All right, I don't know if Nina's on here. The second item has been on our agenda for a while in old business. It's the hospital and tile requirements with the IMBs and the wall care issue. I know the last couple times it's information has gone back and forth, and I know there were discussions being had, and I don't want to take this off until I know we've resolved it one way or another. I don't think
she's not on, Russ, but if I remember correctly, she had him take this off the agenda on the MAC meeting. So by her doing that, maybe it's been resolved.
All right. I will reach out to Nina and see if it's been resolved, and if it is, we'll report it out at the next meeting. Is anybody from Walker on the meeting can talk to it?
Hi, Russ. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah, Tony Piacentini here. I mean, I would say that's my recollection is that, you know, we've been working directly with Nina and others on this, and that it, as well as DMS when inquired about it. And we don't have any outstanding action items as far as we're concerned. So, but you know, glad to follow up with Nina if she says differently when you reach out to her.
Okay. All right. I appreciate that. I'll follow up with Nina and report out at the next meeting. Thank you, Todd. Okay, new business, the serious mental illness task force recommendations. So there were recommendations that came out to the LRC from the mental illness task force in November, mid-November. And one of those was medication adherence. And as I read the recommendations, they recommended the use of long-acting injectable antipsychotics because medication non-adherence is a big issue with rehospitalizations, relapse, and some bad outcomes. But the long-acting injectables would reduce medication schedules, give stable drug levels, decrease hospitalizations. And I know that was a recommendation to DMS that they asked that the MCOs cover the cost of those long-acting injectables, and I guess I wanted either to discuss it or bring it up to the as you go through that, I guess my view is that that would, you know, that those drugs are expensive and not necessarily covered in our per diem. I would say they were not covered in our per diem. And to look at that as an add-on or additional reimbursement when those are given at the end of a hospitalization. I don't think I had, I just wanted to bring it up, and I don't know where DMS is and looking at that recommendation, but as that develops, I think the TAC would like to be involved in those discussions, especially on the reimbursement end.
Russ, this is Lee Geis. Good morning, everyone. When I saw this on the agenda, I was hoping that when you started to talk about it, that you would give a few more details, because I didn't understand why a hospital wouldn't be able to use a long-acting injection or injectable, I should say, in a hospital, but you did, which you said it probably wouldn't be covered in your per diem or in the DRG. So now we can begin to have some more conversation about that with MCOs.
Okay, and I can send you that recommendation letter if we need it. I can send it to everybody on the phone. I apologize for not putting that out there in the invite, but I just wanted to bring that to light. And as I read that, I wanted to make sure start having at least some discussions about that, because that could impact us. It's a good thing, I think, sounds like a good thing for the member, but I want to make sure that the hospitals that are providing it are can do so financially without killing themselves.
Sure, we appreciate that. I appreciate that position and appreciate the information. So okay. We'll begin that discussion now. Thank you, Russ.
Thank you, Lee. I know the next item, getting some reports from different areas about either sporadic application processing. I know we're seeing some here, and I talked to a few others that are seeing it locally with their DCBS, and it's we're not seeing cases, I think, processed in a sequential time frame. So what I mean by that is we're seeing cases from November being processed and approved, but we have newborns that to be added to the mom's case, and others that from June and July and August that still haven't been approved. And the concern that was brought up was that, you know, Medicaid, the patients look to us to help them with the Medicaid approvals if they qualify, and it's not just the hospital stay that we're looking for there. It helps them with their pharmacy and physician offices and their continuum of care and access. We've not really gotten anywhere with our local DCBS, and we know staffing is a concern for everybody on a lot of different levels, not just from clinical care, but from access and frontline and people that are working in these roles as well. So didn't know if DMS has heard that, I don't think it's a critical level, but it's noticeable, and it's hard when we're dealing with patients from June that were still waiting to be processed.
Russ, I have not heard that. This is Lee Geis again. I have not heard that. Is it just your local office there in Owensboro that is you're experiencing delays with?
I know we're experiencing it here. I think we surveyed and there was maybe one or two others. I can get that information too.
Right. If you could send that to me directly, then I can address it with our DCBS partners and see what the problems are.
Okay. And anything we can do to help, we want to, if we're not getting information to them or things that they need, we want to be able to make sure that we're doing what we need to do as well.
Certainly.
So, okay, I'll get that to you, Lee. I appreciate it. Thank you.
No problem.
Hey, Russ. Nina just got in, come into the meeting room. So if you wanted to follow back up with her, just.
Sure. Nina, Nina, this is Russ. The EMTALA requirement issue with the psych hospitals, we left this on here. I wanted to make sure it's still on here until it got resolved. Can you give me an update on your view of that? Has it been resolved?
We took that off the MAC agenda. Matt's pursuing it again directly. It was WellCare. That was the issue. And at the last MAC meeting, or the one before, Matt said to take it off. So,
okay.
Thank you. And I'm sorry, I was sitting in a waiting room for some reason. So,
I'm sorry.
We did join. Sorry, I'm late.
I'm glad you're here.
That was my fault. I had scrolled down on my participants list looking to see if somebody was here. And so I wasn't showing anybody in the waiting room until I realized I had needed to scroll back up. So I apologize.
Okay. Other items? I've got a couple other items, and then I'll open it up to everyone else. We reviewed just recently a pharmacy letter that came out from DMS on the preferred drug list and for fee-for-service pharmacy. And some concerns were brought to me. Some of the ones that are moving to non-preferred are generic. And the preferred is the name brand. And what we see is there's an extreme cost difference from on some of these moves. So for example, the Bupropion, which is a Wellbutrin generic, is moving off the non-preferred, and our acquisition cost for the generic versus the brand name. The generic's $5 for a quantity of 30, and our brand name is over $1,400. And DMS on the payment, the payment's increased as well, but it's a percentage of AWP, and so we actually lose money on a lot of these prescriptions. And with the higher cost, we're losing more money on some of these changes. And I understand. You know, there's probably some reason why this change was made. I don't know if it was a clinical or financial or rebate reason, but financially, I don't see how it makes sense on either side on some of these for these some of these moves. And so, and I just wanted to I don't know if there's somebody on the pharmacy side that at the next meeting we could asked to come and talk to us so that we can understand some of the rationale behind this, because there's several of these that we're going to lose, I mean, money on our direct costs, not even any overhead or pharmacist or any other costs that we have within the pharmacy. We're going to lose just on our direct costs of the medication in a not small way per script. And so we're trying to figure out why this makes sense fiscally.
We can certainly have somebody. Oh, Lee, I'm sorry. Were you getting ready to?
Yeah, I was doing, Shirley was getting ready to say this is a particularly specific issue with pharmacy. I have heard Dr. Fatima address this before at a very high level. And so I think that we will need to invite somebody from pharmacy, unless there's someone on who can. I don't know if Dr. Fatima is here or not.
Well, I didn't have it on the agenda that came up after the agenda was done, so I don't expect anybody to be there. Do I need to reach out to her, or can I send? Will you guys reach out to her to speak?
Once you send the agenda items to me, Russ, I automatically, when I send it out to all the DMS staff, if there's something on there related to pharmacy, I make let Fatima know that we need her to join. And so we can get her on here for the next time. And I'll go ahead and send her an email now. I think I've got yours. Let me pull up when your meeting is in February. February the 22nd.
Yeah, that's what we have as tentative, as long as those work for DMS.
Well, I can go ahead. I'm working on sending out the DMS staff for the meetings, and I'll be sure to include her for y'all's February.
That would be great. I appreciate that. Thank you. Another item I wanted to mention, I saw recently where CMS at the end of the, we're going to be getting to the end of the public health emergency at some point here. And I think I saw CMS extended the period of eligibility determinations. And that's a concern that I brought up before, is how that's going to work. Because this entire period, I don't think we had to do eligibility determinations. And I'm concerned about the roll off of some of the members in our communities and how that impacts them and the hospitals. So CMS has extended that period from, I think, 6 months to 12 months at the end of the public health emergency. But I don't know what the decision date is, or is it effective back to the end of the public health emergency, the day that eligibility determination is made, some other date. And we've sent that to CMS to ask them that question, but I also wanted to ask it here. I wanted to start thinking about how that's, I'd like to understand how that's gonna work. That's gonna help us with how we handle patient issues here and getting them covered maybe for other programs or financial assistance and those type of things. So something to put in front of DMS so that we can talk about it as it gets closer, but that's still a concern of mine and how that's going to impact the membership in the hospitals.
Russ, this is Lee Geiss again. This is a particular responsibility that I'm working on. We refer to it here as the unwinding. So unwinding the public health emergency and the maintenance of effort that was required for the increased FMAP. What that has meant for us is not to terminate anybody who was eligible for Medicaid in March, and or anybody throughout the public health period, except for very specific reasons. So yes, CMS has given guidance that we have 12 months from the end of the public health emergency. So we've been planning under that guidance for several months, looking at or taking into consideration the HHS secretary promising to give us 60 days notice before the end of the PHE, and so that we would have that time to put our plans in place and move forward. Now, that being said, I can assure you that CMS has not made any comments about looking backwards at folks' eligibility, but only going forward. So we would make a redetermination of their eligibility inside that 12 months. At a very high level, our plan is to align some recertification dates, redistribute the workload across that 12-month period so that there'll be no huge impact to either systems processing caseworkers or members or providers, with a large number of members rolling off the eligibility rolls in the same month. So that's our plan. The other plan is to closely watch the Build Back Better bill that's currently in Congress because, excuse me, it contains some different guidance. similar, but a little bit different. So depending on how that bill passes or doesn't pass, but how it comes out of Congress might impact our timing. And because it doesn't refer to the public health emergency ending or not. So it just gives some timelines of when we move forward with unwinding.
Okay. That's good information, because I mean, as we see it, you know, the delta on the number of members was a few hundred thousand, right? From before the public health emergency to now. And with that, those redeterminations, you know, they have to drop back a few hundred thousand people, and the timing on that, like you said, could be, if it was a big bang and it happened all at once, it could be a pretty big wave of issues that we would have to deal with. So I appreciate the cabinet looking at that and DMS looking at that and giving us a glide path as we go through that.
Oh, absolutely. We need everybody who's involved in that, in the whole, it's the whole stream, the whole work stream with the workflow, the downstream effects. We clearly understand that we can't do it, flip a switch and do everything in the first month after the public health emergency ends.
Correct. Any questions on that from anybody? The other last item I have before I open it up, I wanted, this is more for the hospitals that are on the phone. There's been some issues, I think, with some of the CARES Act funding from HRSA. I know the rural payments, there were a few providers in Kentucky that applied for the rural payments, and they have not received those, and they had a hard time getting an answer from HRSA. What the update I got yesterday, it says that HRSA is reviewing those applications. There's still a small percentage of applications that have not been completed, and that the providers will get an email when their application has been reviewed and it's complete. And if and when they will get a payment, but it probably won't be until 2022 when they get that communication. And then on the round four that was announced this week, our understanding is that there's only about 75% of the applications have been processed, and that so the not everyone will see payments for the round four this month, but a good chunk will. So that's an update for the hospitals that I got yesterday. Anybody else have from attack have any other items that they want to discuss? Okay, hearing none. The TAC meetings, I think Charlie they're on this agenda, but they're tentative. I know we put those out there. It's the same. It's the fourth Tuesday of every other month, with the exception of December that we've had for the last couple of years. And if those, I think we're wanting to make sure those work with DMS and there's no conflicts and nothing we have to change. And if those work, we will finalize those and get it on everybody's calendar. We will still continue, as we talked about at our last meeting, continue to do Zoom meetings. I think it works well. It saves some people from travel, especially today when the agenda was shorter and we've only here a half hour rather than an hour or an hour and a half. And that being said, I don't know that I have anything else. Does anybody have anything else for the good of the order? All right. Everybody have a safe and Merry Christmas, and we will talk to you in the new year.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.